better about the structure and also the inner mathematical structure of our Riemann tensor, we continue with the geodesic deviation equation. What's that? Well, we have seen the geodesic equation. Which is telling us, given a vector, parallel transported with respect to itself is equal to zero, and it defines a geodesic line, and we are just looking, given a manifold, what those lines are. Okay? In the case of a sphere, so we get a two-sphere, so a surface is a b-dimensional object, and we embed it in a three-dimensional space just to have a visual impression. Let's take the surface of our Earth. That's a two-dimensional object. We point a vector somewhere, and we parallel transport it. Okay? Therefore, those lines are going to be the maximum circles that are crossing the Earth. If I go straight, I am going along a maximum circle. I change the direction, still, I'm going along a maximum circle, which are the geodesics in this case. What are these guys telling us about gravity? Not much. Not much. Because if I'm living on a geodesic line, as we have seen, these are the lines that are characterizing free-falling objects. If we are speaking about, for example, a massive object, and a free-falling object doesn't experience gravity, right? I was the water in the bottle in the experiment of the first day, and when it was free-falling, there is gravity. Water didn't know that it had to be pushed out of the hole in the bottle because there was no gravity for the water. Therefore, this guy is not telling much about gravity. That's because it's a local measure. It's only one point. We are not referring one point to another point. Okay? And as I already mentioned, what we are actually looking at, if we want to investigate gravity, is some non-local measure. In which, for example, hang on, let's take the sun shining in the middle, let's take the orbit of the Earth is here, let's take, Mars, the orbit is here. Let's take this configuration, where Mars is the closest to the Earth is orbiting around the sun with an higher orbital velocity with respect to Mars, therefore, given a certain interval of time, the Earth is going to be here, Mars is going to be here. As you see, the separation between these two points changed. There was a relative acceleration with respect to each other. Okay? Therefore, you see that by measuring two different points, we realize the fact that there is a gravitational force acting on us. If we take, again, the Earth, let's take something like this, and let's take our bottle, but now we do it sort of gigantic. And you know that the acceleration that we have here, g1, is not a component, is to say g at the position 1, well, let's call it then big A, at the point A, and the acceleration due to gravity up to here is going to be smaller. At the point B, we have that GB, so the absolute value, is going to be smaller than the absolute value of the gravitational acceleration A. You see, two points that tell us about tidal forces. Because this guy is pulled downward, this guy is pulled more downward, therefore what's happening is that there is a stretch. Okay? A tidal force. If you would have a very extended object, let's say a gummy sphere, that that locally, let's say in an empty, completely empty universe, would be a completely spherical sphere, here the sphere would be stretched, because the lower part is pulled more than the upper part, a tidal force. That's also what the water experience on Earth, well, actually, the entire Earth experience. These are the tides, right? Tidal forces come from the tides that we have on Earth. The way we are going to investigate this sort of non-local measure is to consider two different geodesic lines. Run along the geodesic lines and see how the separation is going to change. We are going to try to measure, therefore, an acceleration, so to say, of one geodesic with respect to each other. Or better to say, the acceleration that you would perceive by running along the geodesics. You see, I'm going together. It's like I'm feeling an attraction between the two geodesics. I gave you already the example of ourselves on the surface of the Earth, again, a 2D sphere embedded in a three-dimensional space, just for a visualization. If I am pointing north, a guy there is pointing north as well. We are deciding not to meet, so to say. In a flat geometry, we will never meet, because we are parallel ones with respect to each other, and we will never meet. On the surface of the Earth, so we are dealing with a curved space-time, we walk north, we are pointing at the North Pole, and at a certain point, we meet. We have an acceleration as we meet along, as we run along our geodesics, we are going to meet at a certain point. We feel an attraction. We have an acceleration toward each other that we can interpret as a force. That's what we are going to study now with the geodesic equation. So let's build up the mathematical framework. And what we want to do now is to get a submanifold. We are getting a submanifold out of the total one. Submanifold. What's that? Well, that's actually quite simple. So we start by defining a collection of curves. Of parametric curves. Okay? So this is the curves labeled with S, and T is I'm running along the curve. Okay? So this is a set of curves. And it is a continuous set. So it's a continuous one parameter set of curves. Which curves? We want geodesic lines. All possible geodesic lines? No, we restrict ourselves to non-crossing. So we don't want to study these sort of things, like I'm running, going to the North Pole and somebody's coming like that. We want to have this sort of scenario where they're not crossing each other. So we are selecting them. Now what? We can fix S and ask ourselves what we get. So we now define this object that is a set of points belonging to the manifold, such that the point P is given by this curve, so KST, for a fixed S. Clearly, we are selecting one of these geodesics, S equal to 1, S equal to 3.5, so the one parameter belongs to L. So S belongs to R, sorry. Okay, it's a continuous set. So if we get S fixed, it means we are just selecting one curve, and I'm running along T. So this defines a curve. But then I can also fix T. And I call it C. Now I fix T. Again, that's the collection of points belonging to the manifold, such that P is again described by the collections of families that we have up there, but now I fixed T. Still it is a curve. Because I am running with T along these curves. I fix T, so I say I stop at this P, and then I run along S. It's still a curve. I'm moving from one geodesic to another one. But what we want was to construct a submanifold, and as you see, this construction gives you a sort of a surface because we have two parameters. We have S and T. That's our submanifold. You see, I'm selecting only the points that are characterized by this collection, by this set of functions. Now, to have a sort of something that manages in a better way these two different parameters, I can define a mapping. That now I don't call it gamma, but I call it fancy gamma with the two sticks up here. And this is a function that is a map that is wallowing two real numbers, R and S, and is going to give you what? A point on the manifold, because that's what this gamma is returning, right? P. P belongs to the manifold. I swallow R and S, sorry, S and T, and I get a point on the manifold. Therefore, our fancy gamma is going to swallow S and T, and is going to give us, as it is defined, gamma S T. Okay? Then, our submanifold, therefore, this sort of surface that we defined, is going to be given by the points belonging to the manifolds, such that P is described by this fancy gamma S T. And this subset is contained in M. It belongs to the manifold. Okay? Good. Then we can define a sort of very fancy frame. And we define it with properties that are local. So we can define a vector big T, which is given by D over the T, associated to the curve. So I am a vector associated to the curve where the free variable is given by T. And this vector is is tangent to that line. We have the A of T is equal to zero. Okay? So this defines, you see, I is parallelly transported. And what are parallelly transported vectors? They go along geodesics. Therefore, this is a vector, which is like that. We have our geodesic, we have our curve gamma S. S is fixed, and I'm running with T. And the vector big T is tangent to the geodesic. Then I can define another vector, that's big X. And I define it with respect to the S. And as we have seen in the drawing here, when I'm running along S, I'm jumping from one geodesic to another. Here I'm running along T. Therefore, this guy is going to be a vector that is going toward the other geodesics. We have another geodesic here. For example, X could be pointing in that direction. Now what we can do is to make everything straight, what is called deviation vector, because it's pointing it's pointing toward other geodesics, so that's the deviation with respect to this geodesic. And what we want to achieve now is to have a frame in which X is orthogonal. Oops, sorry. Is orthogonal to big T. To that we can basically apply a fine tuning to the parameter S and T. And this is achieved by, instead of using any arbitrary T, so I'm running along the geodesic in a completely arbitrary way, I'm going to change the sort of speed along which I'm going along the geodesics. And I'm going to make this change of speed along the geodesics geodesic dependent. So each line, when I'm running along each line, I'm running with different speeds. Okay? And T, so from T, I'm going to define a factor which is fixed given a certain geodesic. So that's the geodesic S, plus another factor, S times T. A, S, and B, S are real number fixed given a S. So each, for each geodesic, let's say that this guy, I'm using T, therefore, let's call it geodesic S1 and S2. And for the geodesic S1, I'm choosing T prime equal to zero, so AS, AS1 equal to zero, plus one, meaning BS1 equal to one, and T. So AS1 is equal to zero, BS1 is equal to one. For this other guy here, I can choose another geodesic in which S1 and S2 are going to, sorry, A1, A and B are going to be different. Here I'm going to have AS1, S2, sorry, whatever is the number, plus BS2, whatever is the number characterizing B, and so on for all geodesics. Is it clear? It's actually very simple, okay? So each one I'm running with T in this case. Here I am for the I fixing the speed of T, but the rate along which I'm moving along the geodesic is given by T prime. Okay? What does it mean? If I make B larger than one, here I'm running faster. If B is lower than one, I'm running slower. Therefore, by making this parameterization, I can change my coefficients with respect to S to change the inclination of this vector. And in this way, I can achieve the condition in which the two are orthogonal one with each other. Okay? Good. Then we can give a look at the commutation of these two vectors, T and X, that we already studied. So we, from this expression, we basically find out that T, A delta A X B minus, that's the commutation, right? So the X now with A, delta A T B. So this is the commutator applied to these two guys, as we already did. Minus, we have torsion. I already used T, so let's call it torsion. Component B, B and B, component E, A is contracted. Okay, so that's the commutator that we studied. Now, this guy, now you see, if I set torsion equal to zero, this disappears. What is the commutator? What is the commutator of? There is an equal here. What is the result of the commutator of two vectors defined in the frame? Zero. they define the frame, Tx define the frame, and we know, we have seen that this guy is equal to zero. Now, what I did from here to here, I just made explicit the expression of the commutation of vectors, and I know that is equal to zero. We are in GR, and what I do is to drop torsion, because torsion is equal to zero. We are left only with this guy. It means that I can flip T and X, because the result is that, T A theta A XB is equal to the thing flipped. So I have XA, DA, and TB. Plus torsion B. Okay, we are killing that term. That's good to keep in mind. I give it a number. That's very good. That's going to be very helpful. Good. Then what we can do is nice. Now we know how to run along geodesics. We have a relationship between the x and t vectors, so orthogonal and tangent to the geodesics, and we know they commute one with each other with respect to the covariant as given by the commutator. Now we can define a new guy, which I call geodesic velocity. I don't know if it is called like that. But I just want to tell you, you see there are, I don't know if it's called like that, but let's call it like this to give it a name. This guy tells you what is, if you have two points moving along the geodesics with that t rate, we know what is going to be the acceleration one toward each other. Okay, that's what we are aiming at. And we define this geodesic velocity is a vector, and is just the derivative of, with respect to t, of x. Tb db of x. Let's say the component c, component c. You see, I have the derivative, the directional derivative with respect to t. So I'm asking myself how x, this vector, is changing as I run along a geodesic. Okay, so it's my velocity in that direction as I'm running along the geodesic line. That's the geodesic velocity. Therefore, what we want to have is the geodesic acceleration that I can define now that I have a velocity. And the acceleration along the geodesics is just going to be what? The derivative, again, along the directional derivative along t, so as I'm running along the geodesic, of the velocity geodesic. So I have an acceleration. I manage first the velocity toward the other geodesic, now I have the acceleration toward the other geodesic. And now, if we write everything explicitly, we have CA, TA, TB, B and X component C. Now we can use expression number one, and we flip X and T. They commute because of that, because of the commutation property. Let me go here. Therefore, we are going to have T A, dA, xB, dB, dC, and we would have torsion component B, given a T and given an X. Okay, I carry torsion up to here. to show you that in the end, if we would keep it alive, we would have derivatives of torsion. And therefore, the acceleration along toward another geodesic would depend on derivatives of torsion. Therefore, if there are derivatives of torsion, torsion is a change on the manifold with respect to the position, the tidal forces will be different. Okay? But as I said, we don't consider this guy. This is just to stress you that in several books you will see, this is the geodesic equation. Keep in mind that there might be assumptions in their derivation that they don't mention. And one of those might be this one. So that's the acceleration C. So we continue. And what we do, now we are looking at this guy here, we have a product rule that we need to respect for derivatives. Therefore, we have dA of xB, dB tc, plus tA xB, and then we have double derivative A and B of tc. And now I forget about torsion. This is just product rule. Then we continue, and we can realize something funny. Look here. Start to look like the curvature. So I continue. I keep all of this untouched, so I'm not doing anything to it. But I can apply the inverse of the product rule to this guy, in which I'm going basically to compute first the derivative by leaving B untouched and putting the T inside here. Okay? So what we get is xB, the B, and then we have TA, dA, and tc. So from here to here, I basically placed the t in this position. You see? After the first derivative. After the first derivative. And you see that I changed the indices here because I can just do, because of property number one, because I can flip the commute. But of course, if I use this expression, that's not equal to 1, because then if I apply the product rule, I would have the derivative applied to delta A, would be this guy, but I would have also the derivative of delta B applied to T. Therefore, what I do, I just remove this term. Therefore, I just remove T, never mind. A, B, X, C. Torsion. See, okay. Wait. Oh yes. Okay. Now wait, I'm mistaken. Let me cancel this. Okay, so we arrive up to here, but then we can look at this term. And we have a double derivative of a vector. What did we have in the definition of the curvature? Double derivatives of vectors. Therefore, I can introduce the definition of curvature into here. Let me remind it how it looks like. Curvature, and I will apply it to T and gamma, T and X, so that's the curvature applied to T gamma. That's what we would have there, which is the curvature is defined as dA, dB TC minus dB dA, and then we have TC. Then we would have the part with the commutator. But these vectors are the one defining the frame, and we know that the part that contains the commutator is identically zero, and we don't care about it. So that's what we have. And you see that inside the curvature, I have that bit that I can plug in here. So I bring this guy, I pull it on the other side, and now I have this expression that contains that guy and the curvature, and I put it into here. Okay, so I have equation 2, and now I'm plugging equation 2 into here. What we get is TA XB RC gamma AB T gamma plus TA XB DB TA ATC, and that's it. And now I do apply the inverse of the product rule. So I get my T and I bring it into here. And then I subtract the term that would be of too much. Inverse of the product rule of derivatives. So we have again our equal. This guy is not changed, plus this guy I'm not touching, and I'm working out only this expression. So I'm going to have XB. Then I'm going to have the derivative with respect to B with T inside. Then derivative of A and derivative of C. To which now I need to subtract the term that is of too much, because here I don't have any term that depends on the derivative of T. Therefore, I just subtract it. So I have then minus TA delta A X B and the derivative of B TC. Okay, so you can apply the product rule to this guy. You would obtain this one plus this one. Therefore, to get this one to the entire product rule, we remove the term that we don't need, that was not present here. Okay? Just do it, it's simple. Apply the product rule, you will see that there is one term that cancels with each other, and you're left with this one here. Good. And now what? Ah, look at this guy here. We are parallelly transporting T with respect to T. That's the geodesic equation. And what is the geodesic equation telling you? That this is equal to zero. Therefore, this guy disappears. Is identically zero because of the geodesic equation. Ah, what else do we need to look at? Why I use this trick? Because look at the first term, which is here, and the last one. They are the same, but there is a minus. Therefore, this guy cancels with this one. That's why we use this trick. First of all, to get rid of one term because of the geodesic equation, and then get rid also of the other one because it cancels with this one. And we are only left with this term here. And here we have it. For the geodesic deviation equation, so we have this acceleration toward another, that we perceive toward another geodesic, is equal to, let's remove that, of R C gamma A B T gamma T A S B. This is the geodesic deviation equation. and it tells us the acceleration of one point running along a geodesic toward the other geodesic. That's because the geodesic are not parallel and they can go one toward each other or one apart from each other. Okay? If you are in a void or in an underdensity, it means that you have, for example, this scenario, where this is the gravitational potential, if you think in Newtonian terms. This is deeper, and if we have one point here and one point here, this guy will be accelerating in this direction, this guy will be accelerating in the opposite direction. And the geodesic deviation, given the whatever configuration you have, is going to tell you which kind of acceleration you have with respect to different relative points. In this case, we would have geodesics that are pointing this way, and we are running along the geodesic in this direction, meaning we are following geodesic in opposite direction, we are drew apart. If we have something, a potential which is like this, and we consider two spheres like that, this guy is being accelerated toward the other one, because they're rolling, if you want to speak in these terms, toward the minimum of the potential. Okay? In this case, the geodesics are like that, and we are running along the geodesic in this way. We are moving, accelerating one with respect to each other, one toward each other. This guy, you see, it's a tensor, and is the tensor express. Wait, what is this S? That's an X. This tensor is expressing the tidal forces. This is called tidal stress tensor. You see there is a contraction, alpha and A, gamma and A. We are left with C and B. Therefore, let's call it S, C and B is defined R C, gamma A, B, T, gamma, T, B. No, T, A. Okay? So, you see, we have an acceleration. If we are thinking in terms of matter particles, this is AC, which is coming from the definition of our vector x, here. So you see it's a double derivative with respect to x. So it's a double derivative of the S. That's an acceleration, that's a tidal force. Physically you interpret it as a force. Okay? And again, to stress it once more, what we did here was to abandon torsion, and you understand that in the final equation, if we keep torsion alive, we would have derivatives of torsions here. Too many T's, torsion. These affect the tidal forces. Okay? Good. That's kind of all about the curvature tensor. So we assume what is the meaning for the curvature tensor when we are speaking about parallel transport. We have seen the definition. We have seen the geodesic deviation equation. And you see that, if you want, the curvature is popping up here. Here we use the definition that we had, but we could have just realized these mathematical properties and defined this tensor. Okay? You see, it's popping up from these considerations. Now that we know the mathematics of the curvature, let's try to identify new objects, new mathematical objects based on the curvature. One is the Ricci tensor, and the other one is the Ricci scalar. It's extremely simple. So let's do like this. Other objects, based on Rijks. One is the Ricci tensor. Which is just defined as the contraction of the first and third index of the Riemann tensor. So L is equal to R, well, it's the definition. So we are contracting K with the third one, so it's this one, JL. You see, repeated index, repeated index. Contraction of R, I, J, K, L on first and third index. Is going to be extremely important, this guy, as well. Then we have, and it retains the symmetries that are associated to the Riemann tensor, so inherits those symmetries. And because of that, this guy is symmetric itself. Rjl is equal to Rlj. So it's symmetric. And the symmetry are inherited from the properties of the Riemann tensor. Just need to apply the contraction, and you find out quite easily about the symmetries. That's coming from the property number two that I gave you before. That's a direct consequence of that, which was the anti-symmetry property. They are going to cancel each other during the contraction. Good. Then what? We have the Ricci scala. We have only two indices left. We can apply a contraction to this guy. Therefore, let's make it explicit. GIR, RIJ. So I am applying the contraction of this guy. You see, I have the repeated index. And this is defined as the Ricci scala. This is a scala. Scalar that is going to tell you what is the curvature at a location. Remember that all of this is based on the Riemann tensor. The Riemann tensor is based on the affine connection, and the affine connection is defined through the Christoffel symbol, through the assumptions that we did, with respect to the metric, which is local. Therefore, all of these expressions depends on the position on the manifold. And this scala, actually the unit of the Ricci scala, is 1/m². So it gives you a number for every location on your manifold of the curvature of your space-time. So it's one number that characterizes the curvature. This guy here, instead, is telling you how the volume contained within geodesics differs from the space from flat space-time and a curved space-time. So you can have like two geodesics. Another two geodesics. You can have the case of a flat space and this one, where there is curvature. And this guy here is going to tell you what is the change in volume due to the change of the properties of the space-time, and therefore the direction of the geodesics. Then there is another important one, but there is not time to describe, which is the Einstein tensor. Why is it the Einstein tensor? Because it's the tensor on which we are basing general relativity. But that's for the next time. And you will see this guy, as it's popping up out of our Bianchi identity, and how that tensor is the only tensor, given this framework, that we can use to build up a theory of gravity. There is no other choice. There is no other tensor that allow us to satisfy energy conservations in the terms that we're going to describe, which are not as straightforward as in a flat manifold. And is the only one that has rank 2 tensor containing double derivatives, respect energy conservation, rank 2, and all the properties that we need to arrive at the Einstein-Fields equation that we will derive in two different ways. In one way, we are going to use the approach of Einstein, which was to try out stuff together. Okay, so he tried first with the Ricci tensor and try out if he could build up a theory of gravity, and then he failed with respect to energy conservation. It was completely screwed up. That's why he came up with his other tensor that we are going to describe next time, because this allowed Einstein to fix the problem with energy conservation. With that, then he started to look with his tensor in the hand, do I get gravity? Yeah, I get gravity. Okay? Then we are going to do another approach, which is the one that was set up by Hilbert, and we are going to use a variational approach. So Hilbert defined a Lagrangian, used the least action principle, and arrived, in the end, at the very same equation that Einstein found. Okay? So we will find these two different approaches during the next lectures. Good. For now, that's all. Thank you very much, and I'll see you next time.